Welcome everybody to this edition of the Logica Universalis webinar. Good afternoon, good morning or good evening, depending on where you are. We have as our main speaker today, Andrzej Indrzejczak, who will talk about the topic of the book that he recently edited, that he recently published in the Logica Universalis series with Birkhäuser on sequents and trees. But before we have a presentation by, as usual, by association or organization that is somehow related to the speaker and to Logica Universalis from the country of the speaker. And today this is the Polish Association for Logic and Philosophy of Science. And it is represented here by Marcin Miłkowski. He is a wide spectrum of interests. He's not only a logician, but also computer scientist, does cognitive science, has published a lot on computational theories of mind and things related in that realm. He's a member of the supervision board of this Polish Association for Logic and Philosophy of Science, was a treasurer there, so he's the right person to represent this organization to us. So, Marcin, please. Yeah.
The association has its roots before the Second World War, and you can see now the website on logica.net.pl. It was established in 1936, the Polish Association for Logic, or Polish Logical Association, if you wish. Then it, during the war, it disbanded for obvious reasons. And after the Second World War, it was not really revived. The first attempt at reviving came in 1980-81. That was the first outbreak of the Polish freedom, so to say, with Solidarity Movement. But it never actually saw the light. So it was only in the 90s, after the change of the political regime, that it became possible to register a new association. But this time it was not merely logic, it was also philosophy of science. So it, in 1991, Ryszard Wójcicki, I think he was then the editor-in-chief of Studia Logica, was the first president. Then there were several other presidents like Wojciech Błyszkowski, Ewa Orłowska, Jan Woleński, Grażyna Mirkowska, Roman Murawski, Kazimierz Trzęsicki. I think I was this secretary at the time, and then Janusz Czalakowski, Tomasz Placek, and currently it's Cezary Cieśliński. The association has, I believe, two journals that are published under the auspices, quite obviously Studia Logica, to which it is connected formally and personally in some ways. So Ryszard Wójcicki, the founder, who served as the editor-in-chief, was also the founder of the association, but also another journal, Studies in Logic, Grammar and Rhetoric, the editor-in-chief used to be Witold Marciszewski. Right now it's Kazimierz Trzęsicki. It's also published under the auspices of our association. The association is also related to the series of conferences that you probably all know, Trends in Logic, which is also related to Studia Logica. We are also taking part in this huge endeavor, which is those congresses of methodology, logic, philosophy of science and technology. So we are all always present there. I think the membership right now is 200 something people right now, which is mostly logicians and philosophers of science. So I'm a more like a philosopher of science rather than a logician, so I don't publish in logic. But this is, I think, a pretty consistent mix of interests that that we have here in this association. And I believe that's all I have to say about the association right now. Oh, we also give yearly prizes for interesting books with some bent on international things. So we have some, it should be somewhere here. Okay. Lots of things happening on our website, but the prize is should be somewhere. Is named after Jan Łukasiewicz, whose face was seen here, and it's awarded to a book monograph usually that was published in that year. So that is basically everything I wanted to say about the association before we start a more serious talk about everything else. Thank you for your attention.
Yeah, thank you very much. Is there anybody who would like to comment on this presentation or give any or ask and ask the speaker any questions? You might just either just start talking or use the hand raising tool. Or just send a message through the chat section.
So just a question. So as far as I understand, in Poland, there is no regular congress of about logic and philosophy of science, which is organized every year, every 2 years. That's by this organization. That's the question, because in Brazil, we have the Brazilian Logical Society. By the way, the president of the society is here, as far as I see. And there are some regular meetings in Brazil every 2 or 3 years, gathering all the logicians in the country.
Yeah, we do have that also. And I think it is... right now, it's called International Conference of Philosophy of Science and Formal Methods in Philosophy. It was postponed for obvious reasons this last year and this year. So it's, but we had it's a new initiative. So it was only four editions of this that were organized. So we do have something like that. And we hope that after the pandemic, it will be in still international, but in the live format. So that's a good question. And that's a pretty new, because that there were only four of them right now. So every 2 years.
May I ask one question? Do you have any connection with the Polish Academy of Sciences?
Well, I do. The association doesn't.
Association, yeah.
So the association, I mean, the association uses the address of my institute, actually, of my section. I'm a chair of the section of logic and cognitive science. I'm more in cognitive science than in logic, but we simply... receive the mail, and that's where it's legally registered, the association. So that's the link that there is, but that's all there is. So the institute simply allows us to get the correspondence sent to our address.
Was any time Helena Raseva associated with this? Helena Raseva?
Sorry, I couldn't hear you.
Was Helena Raseva associated with this?
I'm not sure. I would have to go through the archives, but it might not happen. I'm not sure. That I would have to go to see the old documents. So I'm not okay. Here.
Thank you very much. Okay.
A question from David. David Megan.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yep.
Okay. I saw on the slide there that the first organ of the association, Collectiana Logica, had an issue that was prepared, but it never appeared. So I was wondering whether the documents which were to appear in it survived and if they're accessible anywhere.
I believe that at the time there were also two or three editions of another journal that was prepared, and that included quite obviously Alfred Tarski and so on. And that was digitized. I cannot remember it was also a Latin title. But about Collectanea Logica, I have no idea, frankly. August 1939, lots of things were burned in Warsaw at the time. So also a lot of work by Stanisław Leśniewski burned at the time. So could have been the case. I have no idea right now. Never looked at it, frankly. So I would have to look at it if you're interested. Okay, we have some information if you would look on the on my screen. I just found someone saying that there was some copies trying somebody wanted to keep this, so I can check during the seminar and let you know on the chat where it could be found.
Thank you.
So if there is no further question on the Polish Association of Logic and Philosophy of Science, I think we can pass to the speaker of the main speaker of today, who is Andrzej Indrzejczak. Good friend of mine. Also, I think we met already in the 1990s. He's an outstanding logician, professor at the University of Łódź, has worked on various aspects of proof theory, in particular modal logic, has written a textbook on elementary logic in Polish, is organizer of various conferences or series of conferences, in particular conference on non-classical logic, which I think every second year or so normally in normal times is taking place in Łódź. He has worked on propositional sequent calculi, and on these sequent calculi a monograph just appeared with Berghäuser in the Studia Logica series. It's titled Sequence and Trees, and this is also the talk of the title of the talk today. So in the preface to the book, he says this is not an exposition of proof theory, but a methodological study of sequent calculi as such. So to some extent, a pretty philosophical enterprise. Andrzej, please.
Thanks a lot. thanks for the kind words, and thank you also to Jean-Yves for the invitation, for inviting me to participate in this webinar. This is an excellent opportunity for presenting my book, to recommend it, maybe also to provide some excuses for publishing another book on sequence calculus and proof theory. But it's I will try to explain what is the main topic of this book. Maybe I will start. I provided also some slides, so maybe I will try to put them. Oh yes, it's working, I hope. Here it's the short title, but here you have, I hope it's the slides are working, yes, and you see this is a cover of my book, Sequence and Trees, and an introduction to the theory and applications of propositional sequence calculus, the full title. And I'm pretty sure that most of you have a good knowledge of sequence calculus, cut rule and cut elimination theorem and some other similar issues. But anyway, just to, before I will start to present to describe the content of the book, provide a few slides just for fixing terminology and then to make sure that all we know what am I talking about. So by sequence calculi were invented by Gerhard Gensen as one of the amazing discoveries in the history of logic, in my opinion, and I believe not only in my opinion. And so sequence calculus is just a collection of rules where these S are sequence, and sequence in the standard sense are just ordered pairs of formulae in some fixed language. And this gamma delta are called usually antecedent or succedent, and succedent of the sequence. They are just finite collections which are maybe interpreted as sequences. This was the original idea of Gensen, but this, another very, very good interpretation is that they are multisets or simple sets. Sometimes even different kind of data are taken into account by some authors because of their ions. And informally, following Gensen, we can interpret this antecedent as a conjunction of elements and the succedent as a disjunction, because some limit cases are possible. We have just that in case it is empty, one is top and another, and the second one is bot. So these are the rudiments, and rules of sequence calculi are usually divided into two groups of structural rules, where no special constants, logical constants are used. They are just rules which show how to manipulate symbols simply and or sequence. For instance, usual axioms in ordinary sequence calculi, which are just this, or in generalized form, this one have structural character. The famous cut rule has structural character because this phi is arbitrary formula. And you have two forms, one may be called context free, because these are just we are just composing the antecedents and succedents of both premises, and this is context-preserving version. Also, sometimes they are called multiplicative and additive form. Some other well-known structural rules are rules of weakening or contraction. Note that in case we interpret arguments of a sequence as sets, contraction doesn't make sense. Yes, but for other interpretation, it's a vital rule. And logical rules, on the other hand, usually are just for the standard form. Usually we have a pair of rules of introduction of some compound formula with a constant into the antecedent or into the consequent, and they may be presented in multiplicative form or in the additive form. Note one important thing also for many applications, that this one premise multiplicative rule and these two premise additive rules are invertible, in the sense that if we provide one of the interpretation, for instance this one which was on the previous slide, this is not only that conclusion sequent follows logically from premises, but also premises follow logically from the conclusion. These two rules, these two premise multiplicative or this one premise additive rules, are not invertible. And there are, if you take a look at these shapes of these standard rules for conjunction, you can find out a lot of interesting features. They are usually called that these rules are symmetric, because we have a pair of rules introducing the constants to the antecedents or to the succedent, that they are explicit and separate in the sense that only one occurrence of a compound formula is put into antecedent or succedent, and there are no other occurrences of compound formula with the same constant or with other kind of logical constants. Yes? So this is these features are very important for many applications. As well as context insensitivity of these rules, in the sense that this context gamma, delta, pi, sigma, there are no constraints, no side conditions. Yes, put on them. There may be empty or may contain any formulas. And the most important and interesting feature or property of these rules is so-called subformula property, in the sense that the premises are built only from formulas, from subformulas in the improper and proper sense of the formulas which are present in the conclusion. Nothing is added here, and when we get back to the structural rules, we can simply observe that CADIS does not satisfy sub formula property, because this phi may be arbitrary. Yeah, so this is one of the reasons, but not the only one, why CAD per se is not only very important for its application, but it is also very important to have a possibility to show that this rule is redundant, that we can eliminate. It is a famous CAD elimination theorem, which one of the most profound proof theoretic results, which found a lot of applications for many things. So, these are just simple rudiments, and now I will start with some history behind this book. 8 years ago, I published a book in Polish that under the title Sequent Calculi in Classical Logic. And I must say that sequent calculi are not very popular among Polish logicians. And I believed it's a big mistake. And my aim when I was publishing this book was that to provide some introduction to the theory and applications of this kind of calculus, but it was restricted to first order classical logic. And it was, the presentation was quite balanced, that it was a kind of partly a methodological study, but also kind of a treatise on proof theory, presenting some important results, just for mainly for the reader I had in mind was were young logicians in Poland, because I believe that sequent calculus is an elegant and amazing kind of formalization, very useful. I was trying to provide some book when I will show its usefulness and maybe some readers will find it useful for their applications. So, and 2 years after that, I had the great pleasure to take part in the 5th World Congress and School on Universal Logic in Istanbul, the well-known conference organized by Jean-Yves. And on this occasion, I was presenting a 3-part tutorial on the cut elimination theorem, about its importance and about different strategies for proving these results. And during the Congress, Jean-Yves suggested that it would be a good idea to prepare a book about these methodological aspects of sequent calculus. And I say, okay, for me, it was also a good idea. At first, I was simply thinking, okay, I had already my Polish book. I just make a translation of it. But then when I started to thinking about that, I concluded that no, it's a bad idea, because this book will be not a good book for international audience and people who are working with sequent calculus. The scope should be different, and the presentation should be different as well. In particular, it doesn't make sense to restrict it only to classical logic. So, in particular, because during the last 10 years, I was mainly working on the application of sequent calculi and the generalized forms of this calculi to modal, to temporal logics. Recently to definite descriptions. So I thought it is much better to provide something which shows what kind of challenges are provided by non-classical logics, and in what way sequent calculus must evolve in order to provide a good tool for dealing with the specialities of these non-classical logics. This will be the much better, yes. And so I was changing the idea. On the other hand, it appeared that if I want to cover not only classical but at least some non-classical logics in first order version, it is not possible to provide a book of reasonable size. So I consulted it with Jean-Yves and with editors of Birkhäuser, and they kindly agreed that, okay, let's start with the first volume, which will be devoted only to propositional logics. Because in this way, we avoid a lot of technical problems which are connected with quantifiers, operators of different kinds and so on, terms. The notation of the lag and so on, but in a separate way, then can be provided a description of the most basic techniques, as in one volume of reasonable size. This was my idea. If I succeed with that, of course, it may be disputable. But at least I was trying to provide something like that. And what this book is not about. Before I start to provide more detailed description of the content, what this is not about. This is not another treatise on proof theory. This is a lot of books of this kind, very good books of this kind of, on the market. Oh, for instance, these four are my favorite ones. I can say classics, yes, that when, and it was not my idea to provide some more of this kind. So the book Sequence and Trees, at least as it was my idea, it is not about the results in proof theory, but it is about sequence calculus as I said already, wonderful tool for logicians. How we can apply this in different fields. So the focus is not on the results. Of course, results are present. It is not possible to write a book when you are talking about the strategies of proving something when you don't formulate these results and at least do not provide a brief, rough characterization of what's going on. But this is not this aim. What is characteristic for treatises in proof theory is that sequence calculus is treated only as a tool and very often as one of the tools. For instance, in Negri and von Plato's books, and Trostrand, Schwichtenberg, natural deduction is playing a very important role. Yes, it's only the book of Takeuti is such that we have all the time only sequence calculus applied. Yes, but in many other treatises on proof theory, this is just a tool. And very often, the presentation of the results is just with one proof, because there is no reason to provide another one, yes, usually, when the interests are in the results, not in the ways how we can obtain such a result. My aim was different. The focus is on the tools, on the sequence calculus, on the techniques of its application, on the strategies of proving the results. Yes, so results are only something which is in the background. So we can say that it is a kind of methodological study on sequence calculus as such. And but when we are using the term methodological, it may suggest that it is mainly theoretical. Again, I must stress that I was more interested in the providing something which can, for a reader, especially for a novice in the field, be helpful in gaining working knowledge of how to use the sequence calculus for obtaining new results, for formalizing new kind of logics or theories. Yes, this is what was interesting for me. Now, in as I already said, in contrast to my this Polish book, this is not only on classical logic, but there are there is some treatment of some propositional non-classical logic, some. But again, like with results, the logics are not interesting per se in this book. They are just examples, yes, for showing what challenges we find when we are trying to use the tool which was already checked when for its good behavior, for instance, in classical logic, and now we are facing some new problems. And it appears that this tool is not sufficient for that. Yes, we must do something more. We must think about some generalization about some weakening of something. Yes, so The logics per se are not interesting and important in this book. They are just served for the purposes of illustration. That's why there are no the discussion of the big infinite classes of logic and so on. Just selected cases. Maybe this citation from my book will be a good explanation for that. There is a tendency in contemporary works to present very general results. And that's okay, of course. This is theoretically valuable for a novice, but for a novice, it may be hard to follow when he thinks about the how to use the tool. So in this book, we opt for a different road. We rather present several case studies, which are much simpler to grasp. And I believe that after some deep study of this case, you can get some working knowledge and some better orientation, which helps to use this tool for your arms, yes, and also for generate results of much more general character. And this may be said that this is the one of the special features of this book. In contrast to most of the several textbooks on logic, when the tendency is that to focus on very general and uniform results. Other special features. I was trying to provide the book which will be simple to read and users friendly. But in the limits known from Bertrand Russell or maybe Albert Einstein, because this remark is credited one to this author or to this other, that it is important to try to put things as simple as possible, but not simpler. I hope to say that something is simple is very vague. and usually one can criticize that, okay, for the author, it seems simple, but not for the reader. But so I cannot assess my book in this respect. We will see. And I was trying to present several variants of rules and and variants of calculi. And in particular, this, in addition to these standard ones characterized by the rules having all these properties, which were at the beginning of my talk recalled, I described also some non-standard and also some generalized form of calculi, in particular with connection to with the links to non-classical logics. And also I was trying to illustrate what are the advantages, what are the drawbacks of several solutions. Because it would be rather stupid to claim that one of the form of, for instance, sequent calculus is good for everything. Yes, it's nonsense. So I was trying to show that on the several examples. And there is a lot of proofs, not many proofs in the calculi. In fact, there are some examples, illustrations, but the proofs of metalogical results, which can be obtained by means of sequent calculus. So in particular, CAD elimination or CAD admissibility theorem is illustrated with a lot of different strategies of proof. There is also a lot of proofs of completeness theorem using different strategies of decidability, of interpolation theorem. Showing that it is really several variants of sequent calculus are very elegant, provide very elegant formalizations of logic and for obtaining these results. Proofs are presented in detail in the sense that Usually these are some complex induction. So I am trying to put all representative cases in detail. And the rest of the cases are left to the reader, yes, which should be quite easy to complete. And what is the content? There are five chapters in the book, analytic sequence calculus for CPL, classical propositional logic, then Gensen sequence calculus LK. The next one is purely logical sequence calculus. And the fourth is sequence calculi for modal logics. And the fifth, alternatives to classical propositional logics. And in particular, in the first chapter, I introduce only one sequence calculus, which is, in my opinion, the simplest one. In particular, the letter K is for Ivar Ketonen, who may be credited as responsible for this kind of calculus. It is in important respects different from the original Gensen calculus. In particular, sequences are built from finite sets of formulas. And for many proof theoretic reasons, using sequence calculus with sequence of this kind is not a good choice. But it is a good choice for introducing the most elementary problems, because in this way we can forget for a moment about some subtleties and present it as in the simplest, most direct way. So that is why I start with such a form of calculus. And it serves for explanation of the all basic notions concerning subformula property, analyticity, invertibility of rules, confluence. The feature, the property of proof search, in the sense that when all rules are invertible, the order of application of rules doesn't change the result. Of course, it may change the proof, in the sense that some smart order may provide a small proof tree, and some stupid application may provide very big ones. Yes, but anyway, if the sequence is probable, it is probable always. Yes, if it is not probable, you can always find the proof search tree on the basis of which you can provide a counter model. And several proofs of completeness are provided in this chapter, mainly because for this application, using multisets or finite lists or sequences of formulas as a constituents of a sequence doesn't make sense, and it is better to use sets. And so several proofs are provided based on the ideas of Hintikka, Kalmar, Henkin, Avron. There is an extensive discussion of cut rule. What I was trying to explain, why it is important, how it can be interpreted. There is a lot of possible interpretation of that. For what it is, do we need this rule? Why we need to show that it is redundant, yes? So the importance of cut elimination theorem. In this case, admissibility rather, because K is cut-free, yes? We are just showing that cut may be added. And this is a very simple proof showing just the essence of standard techniques for obtaining this result. And also some other matters like decidability, the restriction of cut to some analytic applications, and one proof of interpolation, more semantic in character rather than constructive. and also types of rules and their properties are discussed. So this is the this first chapter is just the basis. I was trying to put in it every first of all, what is the most important and will be present in later chapters. But on the other hand, to show some quite original features as well, like problem of strong completeness in sequent calculus, and in particular some technique strategies introduced by Arno Navro. And then the second chapter is devoted to the original Gensen sequent calculus for classical logic LK, or this propositional part, of course. And a lot of issues from the chapter one are again discussed in this context, but I am showing, I am trying to focus on the differences. In particular, LK is much harder to use for a lot of applications, for instance, for showing the decidability. Some new problems appear in this chapter as well. The problem of structural rules. I am presenting and proving the rule so-called rule generation theorem, which is which I provided in some paper, and this is a kind of a automatic machine for producing different kinds of rules, yes, on the basis of some of some sequent characterizing some constant, yes. Also, problem of permutability of rules. This is the classic results of Pliny. And there is an extensive presentation of many different strategies for proving CAD elimination or CAD admissibility theorem. There is the original proof of Gensen is presented in detail, but also a lot of different techniques due to Tide, Girard, Metcalf, Olivetti, and Gabay, Negri, and von Plato. These are local in the sense that in all these proofs, we are focusing on some application of CAD, and we are showing how to make changes in the proofs locally in this part, either getting rid with this CAD application or changing it on some other CADs, which are captured but suitable induction hypothesis. And there are also two global strategies, two proofs. One is due to Curry and one is due to Bass, which provide strategy for changing the whole proof, not part by part, but by general transformation. The third chapter is devoted to some sequent calculus, which is very popular now, usually called G3, and popularized, for instance, by Negri and von Plato, also by Troelstra and Schwichtenberg, in intuitionistic version by Dragalin. All rules are invertible, so these are some specialties like proving admissibility of structural rules. There are some other proofs of CAD admissibility theorem, basically some of them based strongly on the fact that the rules are invertible, so we can make some changes. Also some proofs of other important results concerning normal forms. Another proof of completeness theorem in the using the strategy of post and normal forms. A lot of constructive proof of interpolation theorem. The most famous one is due to Maehara. It is usually presented in many books and papers, but there are some other which are not well known due to Smulyan, and very, very elegant one due to Muskens and Wintine. tautology elimination result, so-called, which was originally provided by Davies and Putnam, not in the context of sequent calculus, but their special proof procedure, and then brought by Lialetsky and by Brighton in the context of sequent calculus, and it is equivalent to CAD elimination. And also, I finish with very interesting result due to Przenosil concerning the strong completeness and at the same time a kind of normalization of proofs in sequent calculus. And this is quite interesting, and the byproduct of this procedure is also that we obtain interpolants. There is also a discussion of the kinds of rulers and their features, and in particular, because this is the last chapter connected with classical logic, I provide some kind of typology of how sequent calculi may be generalized in order to deal with the problems posed by non-classical logics. And in particular, in chapter 4, it is illustrated for modal logics. It is enough for showing the most central problems. It is enough to use just three logics, T, S4, and S5. Sometimes incidentally, some other logics are involved as well, but these three illustrate very, very well what's going on. In particular, in all of them, special rules for modalities do not satisfy all these features which were mentioned in the context of these rules, for instance, for conjunction. But anyway, for T, the subformula property, at least subformula property, is satisfied. And we can, for this logic, provide constructive CAD elimination theorem. In S4, the subformula property in the strict sense doesn't hold, but anyway, we can still provide constructive CAD elimination theorem. But on the other hand, in both these logics, when you are using the variant with this part invertible rules, there are some problems with providing proof search procedures and showing, constructively showing, decidability. And this problem in T is incidental, but in S4 is quite important. And finally, we have S5, when we cannot even prove CAD elimination theorem in a standard way for standard formalization. And for a lot of this chapter is devoted mainly to S5, because not because it is important and interesting logic, but because it is an interesting polygon for testing techniques and possibilities in sequent calculi. So I am discussing several approaches which were trying to keep the standard sequent calculus. They are due to Min, Serebryanikov, Breuner, Fitting, Gore, Takano, Sato, when by means of different techniques, they were trying to obtain cut-free or at least analytic form of standard sequent calculus for S5. And then there are discussed some non-standard in the sense that the notion of sequent, for instance, is standard notion of sequent is kept, but we admit different kind of rules, for instance, not only introduction, but also elimination rules. And finally, generalized solution using hypersequence, sequence with some added structure, double sequent and so-called bisequent calculi, and which were proposed by, among others, Mintz, Avron, Pottinger, Restall, Poggiolesi, Lahav, Kurokawa, Sato, and me. And the last chapter is devoted to logics which are not extensions of classical logic, but to some weaker logic. And of course, we start with intuitionistic logic, in particular, because the first version LILJ was provided already by Gensen. Yes, but I am discussing also some other form of this calculi, which were especially devoted to providing, for instance, some terminating proof search procedures due to Mintz and Dyckhoff. Some substructural logics. Kosta Doshen and Peter Schroeder-Heister term is used. I should recall that they have invented this name for the showing that for many non-classical logics we can obtain formalization by means of sequent calculus simply by rejecting some structural rules like contraction or weakening. And it works for many interesting non-classical logics, and it is illustrated in this chapter. In particular, I devoted some space for linear logic of Girard. But I must say that the discussion is rather brief because there are other good books due to Paoli, Restall, recently Kathleen Bimbo, where these things are presented in detail. So I was quite brief here. And logics of relevant implication are sometimes treated also as substructural, but simple solutions work only for some of them. And some other require escape from the realm of standard sequent calculus. So this is also a brief discussion of how we can use hypersequence or so-called consecutive calculus of Michael Dunn. And again, the presentation is quite brief. On the other hand, I devoted much more space to many valued logics. Some of them, again, are used as examples for showing what's going on with standard sequent calculus, how we can use it. And there are some proposals due to Avron, Bezio, Priatiel, how to provide special rules for many valued logics in the context of standard sequent calculus. But much more popular solutions in this area were based on the generalization, not necessarily sequence, but because tables were rather more popular in this respect. But if we consider this in the context of sequent calculi, we have generalization of the notion of sequence to as many arguments as we have true values for some logic, which is formalized. And sometimes it is missed that this kind of solution may be presented in both, in two quite different ways. As a verification, I will call these two approaches verificationis and falsificationis version. And I am showing how the differences are visible when we provide sequent calculus presentation of this, and also at least because for verificationist version, constructive elimination theorem were already done by Bass, Vermiller, and Zach. At the time when I was finishing a book, I was unaware that Richard Zach was also did it for falsificationist version. So I presented in this book a proof of CAD elimination for this version as well, claiming that it is the first. Now I know that it's not true because of correspondence, but I am at least justified because this proof was in the Zach thesis. It was not widely, I didn't know this when at the time when I was finishing a book. And then I finish with so-called structured sequent calculus, which in my opinion, a much better solution for many valued logics. In particular, because we have all the time, we have only one proof tree. And in these n-sided approaches, sometimes we are forced to generate a lot of proof search trees. So this is briefly the content of this book, because I said that I am planning to prepare the second volume. So what I'm going to put it will be the sequence calculus for pure first order logic, of course, in several versions. Then the special treatment, different approaches to the treatment of identity and terms. And by terms, I mean not only functions, functional terms, but also, for instance, definite descriptions. Then several kinds of free logics, including so-called quasi and neutral free logics, which are virtually based on free-valued logics, two values and a gap, let's say. And modal logics, and in this respect, I will present widely the approach via different kind of labels. In particular, my favorite one is not that labels are something which is additional device, but in hybrid modal logics, when we use special kind of operators, which are naming the states or possible words. So this, I'm going to provide a deep presentation of this approach. And also some discussion of the kinds of formalization of theories, which will be rather modest because this subject was deeply under deep research in other textbooks. So I will finish my presentation. I have a pleasure to say thanks to express my thanks again to many people, to my colleagues at the first place of the Department of Logic in the University of Łódź, because on the occasion of our regular seminars, I had a lot of occasions to when they provide me some valuable advices. Particularly grateful I am to Andrzej Pietruszczak, professor of logic in Toruń University, who was the reviewer of this Polish book I was mentioning at first. And my collaborators, Michał Zawicki, Nils Kirbis, and Jarosław Petruchin, they really provide a lot of insightful comments to the, they were reading either the parts of the whole drafts of the book. And I am very grateful to them for their help. And to Jean-Yves, of course, for his encouragement to writing the book. And I must say that I was extensively used the style files of generously provided by Sambas on his web page. And it was a great help in devising several proof trees in the book. So I am very grateful for that. Of course, my family, who was enough patient for because during this time I was not necessarily the best member of the family, and finally, of course, the audience for their attention. I'm afraid that my presentation was a bit too long, so thank you again.
Okay, yeah, thank you very much, Andrzej, for this nice guided tour through your book. We have some time for questions and answers, say up to 20 minutes or so. So if somebody would like to ask a question, please preferably use the hand raising tool under the participants menu, or somehow make show somehow otherwise that you would like to ask a question.
What if I can? May I ask something? Yeah. I'm Itala Dottaviano from Brazil. Hello, dear Andrzej. Many thanks for the presentation of your so interesting book. I've seen that you do not present any sequent calculus for upper consistent logics. Don't you intend to deal with this kind of logic? I've seen that you have presented logics of relevant implication, a kind of upper consistent logic, because we have developed some sequent calculi for kinds of upper consistent logic.
There are, in fact, some paraconsistent logic in the book, which serve as an illustration. The simply paraconsistent logics are are not treated as a special kind of logics, because from the, this point of view of the application of sequent calculi, they, I am discussing some free-valued and some four-valued logic in the, this last part of the fifth chapter. For instance, this is the LP logic, the well-known paraconsistent logic. So these are present, yes, but these are just covered under the name of many-valued logics. Okay. I know this is from the point of view of the special features and of paraconsistent logic is not proper, because we can characterize paraconsistent logic, of course, not necessarily by means of many-valued semantics. Yes, but yeah. anyway, for me it was the easiest solution here. So
okay, it seems that you also deal with some kinds of relevant logics too. Maybe some of them are consistent too.
Yes, again, the same, this is the similar problem, that for me, not logics were the most important thing. They were just illustration. And also I was in my mind that I was trying to avoid big discussion about things which are already present in some other textbooks. For example, for relevant logics, already in these big volumes of Anderson and Belknap, we have a lot of sequent calculi of several kinds. Yeah, and this, quite recently, Katalin Bimbo was providing a textbook on proof theory, which is mainly devoted, most of the text is devoted to the very detailed presentation of sequent calculi for relevant logics. And quite recently, Arnon Avron and Ann Zamansky provided the book on paraconsistent logic, when also a lot of sequent calculi are present. Yes.
Yes. So, yes.
That's why I was trying to rather focus on things which, at least in my opinion, are not so well represented in the literature. Yes. And for that, they may be more better for to focus on them.
Okay. Thank you, Andrzej.
I have a question.
Some other questions.
May Mikola Nikitchenko from Ukraine. Andrzej, thank you for your talk. I have a question. Do you plan to write a new book devoted to first order logic and sequent calculus for first order logic and variants?
Mikola, if you mean.
Yes, your book, this was devoted to propositional logic.
Yes, yes.
Do you plan to write a new book?
Yes, this was what I I will keep the same main title, sequence and trees, simply, yes, but there will be some under title called that this will be for first order logic, yes, and this is the plan for the time being, what will be included, yes, mainly in this.
Thank you.
Alexei?
Thank you for your presentation. I have two questions. The first question, so your book is entitled Sequents and Trees. What's the role of trees?
The role of trees is simply the role of the servant. Trees, in fact, one can provide some even algorithmic procedure for changing trees into some linear presentation of proofs. It's not a problem. And sometimes sequent calculi, this is the proofs may be presented in different ways, as some linear sequences or some structured embedded structures, some kind of directed acyclic directed graphs. Trees are very, very easy to use, and in particular a lot of techniques for proving some profound results, yes, in proof theory, make advantage of this tree presentation, because when you have a proof as a tree, then in every part when you cut some subtree, it is also a proof. Proof of something else, of course, yes, but so this is a very nice feature which helps in proofs. It cannot be said, for instance, about some linear presentations of proofs. They generate some additional problems. This is, for instance, in natural deduction, this is the main reason that normalization proofs are presented for natural deduction also as in the form of trees. Although, despite of the fact that it is possible also to provide normalization proof for linear presentation, as far as I remember, some kind of such normalization proof is already present in Fitch textbook. So trees are not intrinsic per se. Yes, only yes, as a handy. Handy presentation of proofs. Yeah.
Yes. But I mean, why did they make it into the title?
Yes.
So I wanted to ask the very same question, because I mean, so if you say sequence and trees, then you ask, well, do you mean sequence versus trees, or trees of sequence, or sequence and trees?
Yeah.
So,
because I believe it's a nice title. Simply. Something which seems to be quite ecological in particular. Yes.
Go green. I have another question. Mm-hmm. More serious, I think. I know that for some model logic systems, there are sequence calculi, but they are kind of useless, bad calculi. Such systems are, to name only a few, GL or Grzegorczyk logic, or on intuitionistic base, KM logic. They don't have good calculi. My question is, do you have any criterion, any test for a good calculus for a system?
It is very difficult, I think, subjectively, I have some my private views on this, but I would be rather not willing to state them as something which I think has an objective value, and I can force it as something which should be taken into account by others. This kind of modal logics, logics of like GL and other relate, closely related, are very specific, in fact. Yes, because for a lot of time there were problems, for instance, with providing constructive CAD elimination proof. Okay, they were provided by very often someone later noticed that, whoa, there are error in the proof. Yes. And now I must say that the things are quite well established in this, in particular, Rajiv Gore and his collaborators were very active also in finding good solution. Also, the whole new branch in proof theory, also using sequent calculus of this non-well-founded proof theory. Yes, it's strongly connected with this kind of modal logic as well. At least the origin of this kind of research, as far as I know, was connected with that. I was thinking that maybe I should also give some presentation and discussion of the application of the sequent calculi to these logics, but I resigned from that, first of all, because the book is already quite big, and the good simple presentation of the problems connected with that, because in particular proof of CAD elimination needs much more inductive parameters, for instance. Yes, and then in my opinion I would like to add at least 50 pages more, so this was one of the reasons that I resigned. I was trying to keep this remembering that it is just an introduction, yes, and then mostly I was thinking about novice interested in the application of sequent calculus. I resigned from that because I thought it may be too difficult. Yes.
Would you agree with the following criterion? For instance, let's take a GL, mm-hmm. and we could call sequent calculus for GL a good one if we can derive from it, from the axiomatization. For instance, Craig interpolation property, which mm-hmm. GL has, fixed point theorem, which yeah. GL has, or disjunctive property or disjunction property, mm-hmm. which GL has. If sequent calculus can accumulate all these properties which can be derived from the axiomatization, then we could call it a good one. Mm-hmm. If we cannot derive some properties which are already known, then it's just just axiomatization and nothing more than that. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Will you agree with this? Would you agree with this?
I agree with this, but making a proviso that it is a good criterion from the point of view of proof theory of these logics, not the machinery of sequent calculus as such. Because if you look at this sequent calculus, at least for GL, you have non-standard rules. Yes, when there is a repetition, yes, of this, for instance, put it this box formula from the succedent to antecedent in the premise, or in Grzegorczyk logic, even the implication. Yes, so from this point of view, which was most important for me, the machinery of sequent calculi, yes. How they are built, what are the good features of it was it was not a good criteria. Yes. So.
Thank you.
Any other question, remark? I have myself a more philosophical question or remark. I mean, the idea that the sequent calculus is perhaps in a sense primary, perhaps even primary to natural deduction. Philosophical, that may be interpreted as saying that the notion of consequence is conceptually prior to the notion of truth. Would you agree with such a more general philosophical interpretation of
certainly, I wholly agree with you. And in particular, it has a very direct illustration when you go to many valued logics. Many of them have no thesis. They are just some consequence relations. And moreover, even having the same kind of the same characterization, semantic characterization in terms of matrices, for instance, for some constants, you can obtain very different logics simply by changing the notion of consequence, and it can be directly modeled in some kind of non-standard or generalized sequent calculus. So it is really in the tool which is directly linked to this view of on logics. Yeah, certainly.
So if there is no further question, I think.
Just a moment, Peter. I think there are some questions which are on the chat. I see.
Let me see. So these are questions to be asked in public or so?
Oh, yeah. I think there is a question by Carrie Butler. Are there any logic which specializes in differentiating between interiority and exteriority? I don't know exactly what it means, but anyway.
Is Carrie still here or so? Okay. Do you have any answer to this, Andrzej?
You in the let me see. You mean this from Carrie Butler to everyone? Are there any logic which specialize in differentiating between interiority and exteriority? I'm not sure if I understand what is here meant by interiority and exteriority. These terms are used in the different ways. And this something more. Sorry, I'm afraid that one sense which is known to me is with the application to labeled systems, that labels may be treated as something exterior, yes, to the some fixed language, or we can use some language where some kind of basically semantic devices are introduced internally, yes, like in hybrid logics. I don't know if this is more specific. How may I clarify interior aspects of an entity versus exterior aspects? Hmm. Sorry, I'm afraid I'm not. I cannot explain because I don't understand what is meant.
Okay, so it seems that there is no further. No further questions. I think then
I have a request. I am Maria Manzano, and I would like in the new book, I would like to have a sequence calculus for many sort of logic. Is that possible?
Yes, of course. And I think that in this second volume, I will try at least to cover briefly this kind of, because again, I don't think to go further in the sense that exploring or providing sequent calculi for second order logic or generally higher order logics. It would take a lot of pages to cover with reasonable elementary presentation. I will rather restrict to the first order logic, but of course introducing many sorts of variables, for instance, is very interesting and advantageous. I know this for example from your book when you show how it can replace application, for instance, of second order logic. Yeah, so I will try to put some discussion of that and some illustration of how it can be done in the context of sequent logic. Yeah. Sequent calculus, sorry.
Okay, so now we are running out of time. We have had 90 minutes. Thank you very much, Andrzej, again for your presentation. Many thanks also to Marcin, and I wonder if Jean-Yves or Antje would like to say anything about the next session of this webinar.
Thank you very much, Peter, and to everybody. So we will have the next session in 1 week exactly, because we have 2 sessions per month. And the next one will be next week. It will be a presentation by Dov Gabay and Tim Kompik about the Talmudic Logic project. So everybody's welcome to join in 1 week, next week.